Podcast Network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans. Producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows. Interviewing celebrities and showrunners. And bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hey there, Helix fans. Welcome back to the Helix After Show here on AfterBuzz TV. Talking about Season 2, Episode 6, M. Domestica. I'm Matt Lieberman. Joining me, as always, fantastic panels all here. Zach Wilson.
Hey, guys.
Stephen Lemieux is here.
Hey, guys. Follow me on Twitter, at Stephen Lemieux, S-T-P-H-E-N-L-E-M-I-U-X.
All right. We're going to do that in a second. Liz Rishmawy is here.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
And we have a very special guest, Mr. Mark Ghanime is back.
Thanks for having me back.
Yeah, absolutely, anytime. So this episode was, first of all, excellent, building on the momentum that we got last week. A lot of answers this week, a lot of big developments, a lot of new mycotics. We got to check in with Sergio, we got to check in with present Julia. How'd you guys feel?
This was the free-fall episode. This was where they set everything in motion to just get really, really terrible and bad.
Which always usually happens on the fifth episode.
Yeah, fifth and sixth episode. Like the first. Well, I guess we only have one season to go on for this, but in the first season, it was the fifth episode, I believe, halfway through the fifth episode where everything went terrible. And this one, I'm like, oh, they're poisoning everyone. Oh, they're eating it. Oh, okay. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. But if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yeah.
I mean, break it more by introducing, right, like, some honeyses to just...
Smartest decision they made in the episode was not poisoning everyone, though.
Yes.
I'm glad they could get a large group of people outside of the infected, though.
And I'm glad that their cult members are stupid enough to not realize, wow, this berry is really sticky. It's, like, stickier than normal. I'm gonna eat it. I don't know. I don't understand how you put honey.
Considering
anytime communion tastes better is a good day in my book.
Well, Liz brings up a fair point because only a couple episodes ago, Brother Michael said that they don't eat the honey; that they only eat the fruits and the vegetables.
Yeah.
So somebody would notice that it's preserved.
It's got a totally different flavor from blackberry plus honey.
Maybe they're just
but it's a special strain that they have, like, have that grandma or
but it wasn't
Agnes
like it was new
made.
To them.
It was straight up honey with blackberries.
Yeah,
but
that sounds amazing right now.
But who doesn't love honey? So who's
gonna
complain?
It's true. Who's gonna speak up?
Hey, this tastes good. Stop giving it to me.
Just this is way too sweet.
Right.
I wanted something sour.
Speaking of sweet and speaking of sour, I know you were a little disappointed in me today when I showed up without candy.
Yes.
Do you think I would actually do that? Come on.
No. No.
And just
no,
for
Mark,
you,
shut
so
up.
You can crinkle and crumple and do all sorts of fun stuff. Taping.
It's the exact same.
No, take it away from Liz.
No, I just want one now.
You know, no, let's do that later so that we save his sanity for the
Mark,
show.
Mark, you know
hold on,
how
whatever.
I feel about
this.
Can I
just keep it in my lap so when, like, Matt just goes on a tangent, I can still like that.
Oh, my God.
Please don't.
Okay. I just have to wonder, with this community, they're like, it's like, this is the berries of Christ.
Yeah.
This is the honey of Christ. Suckle from his honey suckle.
It is fair, though. Not even necessarily the taste, because you could... You could argue that the berries are sweet or whatever, but wouldn't the honey have made them sticky?
That's what I just said.
Yeah, they already said it was sticky. Here, right. Before we get too deep into this, because I can already tell this is going to be a very special episode, ignoring that.
And speaking of getting deep, let's talk about that opening scene. Well, okay, go on.
For those of you who are watching us live on YouTube, hello. Welcome to the show. You can, as always, you can write to us right there in the chat roll, or you can tweet at us live on Twitter. We're going to give out our Twitter handles. Mine is, as always, Matt Lieberman. That's MattLieberman.
Hey, guys. I'm Liz Rishmawy, and you can tweet me at Lizzie Maui. That's LizzyMawy.
If you want to tweet to Sergio, it's at Mark Ghanime, MarkGhanime.
I already said it earlier, like a dick.
Yeah. Well, I'm Zach Wilson at that Zach Wilson. T-H-A-T-Z-A-C-H-W-I-L-S-O-N.
Okay. So, Let's jump right in. I want to talk about you, Mark, and your return to the show. Obviously, we've been eagerly anticipating Sergio's return. We were kind of wondering how on earth he was going to work into the show.
Aside from just looking out over Awkward Window.
Right.
Awkward Window made its return.
Awkward Window came back for season two in full force. You know, that's what one of the struggles was as far as the writers discussed with me between season one and season two was how to implement Sergio back into the story without making it seem like just way too, you know, Scooby-Doo at the end of an episode. We're all back together, gang, you know? So there was talk about bringing me in later on in the season and trying to figure out how he could fit into present day and the situation on the island and all that and how he's involved. So yeah, it was very difficult to watch all the action on Twitter for the first three episodes. And leading up, and everybody asking, you know, because everyone's tweeting like pre-production, on-set filming photos, all these things that were just happening on the days when we were making the show, and I couldn't do anything. I'd be silent. You know, even though there's footage of me on YouTube at Comic-Con talking about coming back for season two.
Right.
You know, it's the internet. Nobody's going to see it. Nobody watches the internet.
I'm sorry.
So I was, you know, I had to remain silent, and it was like just sitting there handcuffed going, oh man, everyone's having all this.
Oh, don't mention
fun.
Handcuffs after the whole 50 Shades of Sergio jokes.
No, Julia's the one handcuffed
there.
That's
a different animal that got away from everybody, it seems, in the last few days. But, no, it's definitely been fun to come back and give some people what they've been looking for. I think they've been waiting for the character and enjoyed the return of Sergio, and I was happy to come back and flesh it out some more for season two.
Yeah.
Flesh it out, no kidding.
Sort of intended.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, it's interesting because Sergio is the contact with Peter at Ilaria, which means Julia obviously knows that Peter is working for Ilaria.
I don't know that that's obvious. I mean, and maybe you can speak to that, Mark, but they're, you know, just because they're sleeping together doesn't mean that he shares all of his duties with her.
But they do seem to be not...
They're in cahoots.
They're in cahoots trying to, like, prevent Ilaria's big genocide.
Right.
You know, some of these questions obviously will get answered.
Well, really, I'm just trying to figure out the timeline, because I know there's present and future, but is everything that we saw with you guys, with present. You and Julia, present happening at the same time as the outbreak as the island?
On day six.
Yeah.
Is this all happening on day six?
I mean, as far as we see, doesn't it seem that way?
Yeah.
It does and it doesn't, because...
I mean, unless
you're
I'm immortal.
Famous.
Well, otherwise, you know, like if I was in that future segment 23,000 days later.
Well, let me say why I'm asking.
Be a little bit older looking.
The reason I ask is because obviously Madam whatever her name tells Julia about this island with the cult on it when you're already communicating with Peter Farragut, who's already on the island, which is kind of convenient.
That's what I was going to say. I think it is, because any scene that we've seen with Julia, it always is a flash forward to the scene where you see like the growth of trees and stuff, and it says years later.
It's definitely not 30 years in the future.
It's during the same time. No?
Yeah, I think it's pretty clear that it's on day six. My only question about whether or not maybe it was before day one.
Day negative something.
Exactly.
Yeah, I was thinking it was like before day one.
That's the only thing that it could have possibly been other than day six. But since no day marker ever came up, there was no visual cue to show that it was a flashback, and because it was threaded through the episode without any kind of denotation that we were looking at something different, I think it's safe to say this is all happening on day six.
Yeah, I think
to answer the question where you said off the top of just before this discussion started about Julia not knowing I'm in contact with Peter. I mean, you saw her show up in that board meeting, kind of. You know, they started the board meeting without her. They were intending to railroad her.
Yeah.
And so she's been left out of some information pieces through the beginning of this season. So it's entirely possible that I've got some info that she doesn't have.
Because that makes me think that you're playing both sides of the coin then, because in your, which is so
very
like your character.
Astute.
Oh my God.
Very astute.
No, because you're working with Peter, and if Julia doesn't know you're working with Peter, then it's going to be, her now wanting to go to this island, and now you're kind of like, well, let me just tell you something about Saint Germain.
Let me tell you what I know about this island. Yeah.
Your ex-husband's there.
Well, I guess the question...
And the guy you slept with's there.
Here, Zach.
Well, I guess the question that we have to ask at this point is, what does Sergio want? Like, the last time we saw him, like, that's last season, question. Was he wanted to track down the children that had been taken in by Arctic Biosystems and then sent out, and he wanted to track them down, find out where they went.
He also had started a relationship.
Yeah. He wanted to get his banana on.
What happened to banana? Now we've got Bulia. I don't get it. And why is Sergio effectively the mortal slam piece of the Alaria Corporation?
That's what he is on the payroll.
It's those teeth.
It's on his
teeth.
Business cards.
You know, I don't know. I really can't answer that question. We have some very feisty writers, I think, you know, that like to see this sort of stuff happen. As far as the banana shipping,
the banana,
yeah,
you know that remains to be seen.
Okay.
Figuring out the tie-in to that or the tie-up if it is. And yeah, I mean Sergio likes to implement himself where he's going to benefit, but I also think this season is a different story for him. He's more focused, and he's not just the mustache twirling bad guy. Mm-hmm. You saw him in the boardroom, and they're talking about the end of the world, and he doesn't want that to happen.
Yeah.
You know, he's not interested in wiping out. You know,
well, he's never really been the mustache twirly guy. He's always had like this depth to him that we've always like he's bad in the first or second episode, and then there's always more there.
Opportunistic for sure.
Yeah,
and will do bad things to protect himself or protect his mission, but he's not into genocide. It's not really his bag.
Sure.
Yeah,
not many people's bag.
I'm sorry. I'm also just like I was laughing before at the whole thing with like him with Julia and then being on the island and then your husband's on the air, ex-husband's on the island and also the guy that you bang when you're with your husband. And I'm just picturing him like, why are you calling this line? Listen, while I have you, does she like it when you do that thing with the thing?
I don't think something tells
Maybe.
Me Sergio don't need no tips.
Well, I mean, even in that bedroom scene, I mean, with Julia calling out Alan's name,
yeah,
it didn't really affect him because I mean, Sergio's no Kanye. He's gonna let you finish.
That's true.
So she's gotta get her fix, and he was happy to oblige, you know.
Yeah.
But that's just
very nice of him not
hurt,
to take
he didn't even
any
look
offense.
Hurt.
Yeah,
he literally just kind of blinked, and he's like.
Yeah.
Like, it literally is like, sigh, baby. It's
you know?
Okay.
I think that says to me that this is not just, like, it's not as simple as he's just, like, having fun.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, oh, I'm gonna get laid tonight. No, it's like, this is a power move, in
right.
a way. Like, he had this sudden by the proverbial balls by, like, having her in a relationship with him.
Sure.
Well, to be honest, though, I also think not only that, but if you're in this very secretive, elite, you know, company or corporation or something, you're probably limited to the amount of people that you can actually have some sort of relationship with. So if you're gonna like have some sort of thing, it's like, look, we both know what this is. We can't get into relationships with anybody, but we know each other from back in the thing. Like, let's just relieve some stress.
Yeah,
like,
something.
I just, you know.
So let me ask you, Mark. How much did the writers talk to you about? This relationship between you and Julia, like, what do you know about how it started? What can you tell us about why they're together and what to look forward to on this Alaria side of things?
Well, I mean, you're going to see in the next few episodes some development in that, and you'll get some answers as far as what my motives are and why I'm involved with Julia and you know, whether my feelings are just purely motivated by the business of it all, or if there's something there. The writers in the summer when we started talking about season two gave me some indication of some things that were going to occur. And then, you know, as it does with a lot of television, things change and writing happens to be, you know, it takes like a 180 mm-hmm. and goes in a different direction. So I just decided to just wait for the scripts and see what was happening and try and figure it out for myself, and which was kind of fun too.
Which we're starting to figure it out ourselves. Now, Julia, she runs afoul of some other board members. They want to wipe out 75% of the human population. She's way not into it. And she has a home invasion by a fellow board member who cooks her a perfect coq au vin.
Someone remind me what that is.
It is a French dish. It's a chicken and white wine.
Ah.
Yeah. It's a very...
It sounds delicious.
I know. I'm like,
it's a bird.
Because yeah. I just love the end. It's just like, my God, this is perfect. Like, yeah. or something. Yeah.
Well, if you're immortal, she spent 100 years...
Yeah, perfecting it.
Perfecting it. And, like, not just, like, I make a really good... Perfecting it.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. If you've got that long, like, right. your hobby list has to get pretty long.
Right.
to, like, just stuff that you can figure out how to do.
Yeah, so absolutely. we're kind of jumping into Julie and Sergio right now with everything.
Right. Right. Can we wrap that up before we move on? Or
yeah, I was going to keep going. I was going with that. I wanted to talk about where Sergio's talking about how he wants to get through guilt by association. He's worried for his own ass through this, and she gives you the Narvik virus, which is the cure to what they're trying to release on the planet.
Just before you talk about that, his association and wanting to join her, it wasn't to save his own ass.
It's to save everyone on Earth.
Well, yeah, and it wasn't a selfless comment. It was more about her. Like, she's going off to do this thing, and then he doesn't want to let her just do it by herself.
Oh, okay.
You know, because, I mean, there's been some time since Arctic biosystems and relationships have formed, and, you know, you don't always get to choose the situations that you're put in, like especially with these kind of
people
viruses and these
high
people
stakes,
you know, and so you kind of roll with the punches and you try and figure things out as you go. And he's developed, he cares about things now as opposed to just himself. So that was it. Like, it was not just like, I'm gonna save my own ass. It's not guilty by association. Like, I gotta do this because otherwise I'm gonna get in trouble. It was more like, you know, and she talked about the safe houses, and he's like, yeah, and like they're gonna, like, I'll be safe there.
Yeah.
Like, let's be honest. I'm better suited.
Come on, Julia. You know? Let's hide from this organization by using one of their safe houses.
Right.
Well, real quick too, I was also gonna say, you know, when we thought at that scene when the woman from the board meeting went into her house, you know, you see that, you know, like, she was like, oh, like, Bioceros told you. So automatically our jumping is, oh, no, he betrayed her. But then we find out that this woman's on the same page.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it just goes, like, that was my thing immediately when I started to question Sergio's motives. I was like, oh, well, if he did say it, he only said it to the person who he knows is also on the same team.
Right.
She did give up her, like, eight little in there, though. Like, not very sly, Julia. Because, like, by saying that he could have given it her that information...
And then she would have been like, who?
Well, she drops the ball where, like, now she can't use him as a source anymore.
Yeah.
Right. So we also introduce a new character, the Mademoiselle, the petite Mademoiselle.
Who knows the scythe.
Yeah. Who knows? Well, not only knows the scythe, but is a scientist and is somebody who's been working for Laria for a very long time. Very intelligent. She mentions another renegade who's working on something. Now, the quick assumption is that she's talking about Brother Michael. But what do you guys think?
Definitely.
Definitely?
I would say 100%.
Yeah.
It's Michael. Especially based on, like, what we've seen. And, again, I draw to this from this sometimes, the Helix access granted.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they had Ilaria watching him, like, aware that he's, like, they're keeping an eye on him, but he's clearly not with them.
Right.
So they that's who is... keeping an eye is the Mademoiselle Durand, I believe it is.
I don't think they were meaning for there to be any question whether they're talking about Michael or not. That's why the necklace has the tree symbol and it cuts directly over to the cult. I think what's interesting here is because Ilaria is watching him for one reason, which is probably what the cult thinks he's doing, and then she probably knows what he's really doing, which is what's happening behind closed doors. With am I correct in assuming? Well, I'm probably not. Nobody knows if I'm correct, but when we saw the tube going into the woman and pumping her full of the honeys was that the planting process? Was that supposed to be...
No, the planting is when he sleeps with his daughters.
You don't know that, though.
The planting is when he sleeps with his daughters. I think they made that abundantly clear in this episode.
It sounds a little bit weirder than the mating.
This is for something even more fun.
Wait, how does it sound weirder
even
than...
more disturbing.
Oh, fun.
Yeah.
Wait, thank you. More disturbing?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, just wait.
All right, so we're already halfway through the show. We only have a half hour left
Damn.
To talk about the rest of everything. So I'm just going to say, go to iTunes, support the show. We appreciate it. Your ratings and reviews matter and help keep our doors open. That's all I'm going to say of the spiel. Now, one thing that we talked about either last week or the week before was the idea of Kyle Summer, Dr. Dick Texas, being this season's Sergio, which I don't agree with.
I don't agree with either.
It's a trap that you can fall into very easily of trying to compare one season to another because they're obviously not the same animal. Helix, between its two seasons, seems to have thrived on recycling not story elements per se, but a pattern of revealing information and a pacing of storytelling. And certain character types. Now, I don't want to say pigeonhole someone and say they're this character this season or this character, whatever. But if we are going to play that game, which I couldn't help but do this episode, I would say that Kyle Summer, in many ways, is this season's season one Alan Farragut. Somebody who's constantly asking questions, constantly getting the shit end of the stick, and things just aren't going well for him, and it's just kind of like
that's fair.
Become the hero he was meant to be.
He's the only one that's being fully honest with the CDC.
Only one. And then the other thing is we've got Amy, who, in my opinion, is this season's Sergio, of somebody who is doing incredibly messed up stuff, but as we come to understand their motivation and learn more about them, as much as I hate what she does, now that I understand why she does it, I can't help but support her.
You know, and I gotta say, Allison Lauder, who plays Amy, she's been a great addition to the cast. She's very well suited for that role. She's just very fun and brings a lot of great energy. And it was a blast to see her work for leading up to this this part of the season. Absolutely, I think she's this season Sergio. She's the ship disturber. She's causing a lot of she's a catalyst to a lot of crazy events. In the season, like last season with my character, I was killing Doreen, I was killing people, I was burning the monkeys, I was doing all these things that caused people to go, "What the
monkeys!"
What is this, right? And it's her turn this year is to kind of go through and wreck house.
Mm-hmm. Well, when she did the thing with the kids where they beat up Second Sergio, I'm still calling him Second Sergio.
No, it's so confusing. Please don't.
Don't.
Please, he already has.
He's Dr. Dick Texas.
Dr. Can we
Double
get
Dick
a,
Texas?
No, just one dick is what he's got.
This is Helix. So.
Unless
His
Michael,
name is Matt Long.
A Helix is a dual Helix.
Michael's very good at grafting things.
Yeah. Can we please make your point?
I'm just comparing it to how she took the kids and did that, and you blew up the satellite, and there's just every step of the way, there's a different thing where you don't know where she lies. And I love, there was a really powerful scene between her and Anne this episode, where Anne is telling her that everything's fine, you know, everything's fine, and she's like, no, I'm pretty sure Agnes found out that somebody else has a silver eyes, and then she's dead the next day.
Yeah, like,
everything's
what's wrong
fine.
With you?
Yeah, really.
Can I just say, too, I feel like how interesting her character development is, because for her to have become such a headstrong person with so many of her own ideas and thoughts and desires and wants to get off the island, but for somebody who was raised in this environment to have not, like, basically... I mean, it's amazing to me. That's all you've known your entire life.
And she still
and
hasn't drank
it's
the
wrong.
Kool-Aid.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I think that is what most fascinating to me about her character, not only just her intellect in general, but the fact that your entire life has been this as your world in society, and you know it's wrong, and it's effed up.
Doesn't it make more sense now that she was trying to sleep with Second Sergio / Double Dick Texas? It makes more sense, though, because if he knocked her up, she wouldn't be able to get knocked up on her 20th birthday by her dad.
But that's why
true.
She could also, like, you know,
I just
stop
said
giving
that sentence,
handry.
Didn't I? I've never thought I'd say
hand
that
jobs.
Sentence.
It's called land jobs.
Land jobs?
Handry.
Oh. Handry gives land jobs.
Gets.
Patented.
Gets. By the way, he gets land jobs.
I want to just, like, shout out to one of our long followers, the Divine Miss L.
Oh.
And Oh, I thought she wrote more than this, but no, Mark didn't bring Coke bottles this time.
I brought some really incredible caramels, salted caramels. Yeah. I brought some sour
salted caramels in there?
I got cranberry with dark chocolate, and I got Skittles.
Hey, girl. I took a picture.
Taste the rainbow.
Yeah. We should.
But yeah, that was important. So,
taste the rainbow.
So let's talk macro here. Now that we have some key pieces of information, we don't know what the mother root is. We don't know what the mother is, but we do know that that Brother Michael's kids are. Well, his first kid was half human, half silver, and he's been trying to break down and reduce the amount of human in them over a period of 500 years. I think it was Stephen, or maybe even all of you, who were saying that his goal was to create more silvers, at least from his own bloodline, seems to be now kind of more in line with what he's doing.
Just to create a subreddit of that comment real quick, you know you like that. When the woman in when the woman in Ilaria was talking about how nobody wants to be stuck on a planet with the same boring silver-eyed people all the time, so I feel like this is where Brother Michael's motivations come from. He wants to create new silver eyes because he probably was sick of them.
So that's interesting because it implies that the whatever event it was that brought about silvers was not something that was repeatable. Mm-hmm. So when they said there can only be 500 at a time, maybe that was like that's not like a rule that they had to set, but it was just like there were only 500 of them, and they until Hitaki came up with whatever he did last season to Julia, there wasn't a way to replicate it. And so Julia would in that sense hold the key to replicating silvers. And vice versa, and then if so facto,
baby.
So would Sarah.
Yeah.
So Julia
because
is,
she's part. She got her silver from Julia.
Right.
So what? Basically, okay. So Brother Michael has been breeding with humans, trying to increase the power of the immortal and decrease the power of the mortal. Hitaki just did it in one shot with Julia, and just with science.
I will save your life.
With science, forced it to push the immortal side to take over the mortal side.
Or maybe it's that just because Michael's been on this island so long, because he's been there at least 500 years, if not more. Mm-hmm.
I think
he's been away from science for so long. He's still using the 500-year-old techniques, which is just breeding, like just like
you would,
like GMOs, like classic.
Technology's not there.
Yeah. Classic GMOs, like corn. The Native Americans were making corn. They just bred two strains of corn until it was the sweet corn that they wanted. And so he's breeding humans with himself until he gets the baby that he wants.
Hey, he waits till they're 20, all right? You know, that's respectable.
But can I just... Oh, my God, stop.
If you're going to go back 400 years, okay. Let's just say that's pretty respectable.
Stephen, we don't know when he reached that idea, that limit.
And I also want to just say, too, like...
Might not have always been 20.
My confusion...
Wow.
Liz.
My confusion, though, is the fact that even if there were a silver-eyed child to, you know, be born from one of these disgusting breeding techniques, but, like, I don't understand what the point would be if they are stuck at that age when they are silver-eyed.
Baby army.
It's a very fair point because
she might have poked a hole in something there.
Right. Well, I know you didn't mean anything.
He didn't
mean anything either.
No, he didn't.
That was purely innocent.
You brought the candy.
The
I don't trust you.
That seems really perverted. This was actually very
I poked a hole in a theory.
It's true. But that's the thing is if
the theory holds is
if he was able to have a baby that was silver, would it ever like Sarah's baby, would it ever actually gestate? Because here's the difference. Sarah was already pregnant when she became a silver versus a silver actually having a kid with another silver, which is impossible. It has never happened. That is why they've been able to maintain the 500. They cannot have kids with each other.
They haven't said that though. Is it possible that the female silvers can get pregnant and just have a human baby?
I don't know.
Scythe was what's her name's son,
we would
right?
have to assume.
Sutton's son.
But he was always that age, which means they became.
When they became silver together. Okay, so, yeah, exactly.
My question is, what if he's not trying to create silvers at all? What if what he's really trying to do is just make a human that has the same capabilities as silvers?
What?
No, that would just be a silver.
No, but you don't have the silver eyes. They still grow, but they just live longer. Like, he's basically just...
Oh, create like a type of human that would live like 500 years instead of 100?
Or retain their youth for longer.
Like a vampire.
He doesn't like anyone who looks too old.
So this is all just a ploy for Oil Valet, basically, to make a much better product.
Yes.
We figure it out, we make a cream, we sell it to you.
You didn't know that...
Or he's just going to have a baby and farm stem cells from it.
At Oil Valet Twitter.
He does not like it. He's not attracted to anyone over the age of 20. He's not attracted to anyone over the age of 20.
It's so gross.
Okay. I had a thought, but I think it's like trying to escape me right now.
Do it. Oh, you mean it already?
If it comes back. Let's talk about Peter down in the black hole.
Yeah. Wait, what's the French word for it again? It's
an oubliette.
Oubliette.
Oh, that's what I was gonna say. Sorry, I hate to backtrack.
That's right.
Actually, I love to do it.
You do.
So what? I think in the next few episodes, we're probably going to get Brother Michael's past, because judging by him having a strong need to create a child that is like him, I feel like he was turned with his family, and he lost them all at the same time. And I want to see what drove him to try to create more of him.
Yeah. I'm also very curious Is that invoking the first woman that he, made a child with? Or is it talking about a plant? Is it talking about a great tree? The great tree that we've seen several times in imagery, even in this episode?
Yeah.
I don't know. We also have the mystery of this pollen and why the apples aren't getting people sick, but the honey is.
The pollen, yeah.
Yeah. Well,
from the apples. It's the pollen from the apple trees, but it's not the apples itself.
Exactly. The apples are safe to eat, but the pollen and the honey is not safe. So there's a lot going on there. I'm sure that we'll have more thoughts as we continue. I want to talk about Peter in this dank hole.
Bleat.
Yeah. So, Mark, how much do you know about Peter's mission and Sergio's role in it? Can you not tell us anything?
Absolutely. I can't tell you anything.
Super.
That's the fun thing about these kind of shows is that it is all hinging on these great events to kind of like make you go the era of what the fuck television, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can I say that?
I guess. She already
I did.
Yeah.
We were just talking about a guy who has sex with his own children more children. Say, whatever.
Yeah, but that doesn't involve a bad word.
Wait, you mean Walter Frey? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
Walter Frey.
Yeah.
I feel like I missed that.
There. Game of Thrones.
I haven't caught up yet. But yeah, there's just so much going on in this show that you just have to leave something for every episode. I can't tell you everything about Peter and his job in the hole.
So the finale, the final scene of the season. I really want to talk about this for a second.
So, how many more suits will we be seeing Sergio wear? Can we get a number?
He's actually getting fitted for the Tinky Winky suit from the Teletubbies. So he's
going to
be in episode 14, which is a special reveal. Is Sergio Winky? No, I can't tell you.
I just really hope we get a screener for the finale that has, like, instead of special effects, big red letters on the screen that says what's supposed to be happening. That was the highlight of last season for me.
Oh, okay. Big explosion.
Oh, yeah. For those who don't know, what we actually got to, we felt very special. We got to see the very last season finale episode before it aired on Syfy. But what we watched was still slightly not correct.
It was unfinished.
It was a press version.
Special effects.
Yeah, but it would be great because there was supposed to be like an explosion. It says insert explosion here. It was
And speaking of if something was special inserted special effect, the girl that knocked Peter down in the hole. We were talking a little bit beforehand. The thought came up, is she real?
Wow.
Where did she come from? Because who was that? Where did she come from?
They couldn't have rounded up everybody. They couldn't have rounded up everybody that got infected.
But didn't we say before in our conversation that this was a woman who was seen in like the first episode or second episode?
I only saw the episode once, and I just like it was when I was watching it. I couldn't really. It was the lighting. I couldn't tell her face perfectly, but I thought she'd been involved.
I guess
season two already.
I just thought it was very interesting though, because in that scene, because I was the one who brought it up. That, you know, this is a room that's locked and, like, nobody seems to be guarding it because there's no reason to guard it, and that's how Alan got out before.
Right.
So why all of a sudden, when poor Peter's like, yeah, rock climbing come into effect and handy, and then this girl's like, hey, this little baby went to market. This, and then, wait, what happened?
He does his own stunts.
Yeah, I know.
Does he? Gosh.
Yeah, have you seen some of his pictures of him not wearing a shirt? Bro is jacked.
And he climbed up that sucker on his own.
Good for him.
I think she's the girl that we saw having stuff shoved into her.
That
phrasing, yeah, I know, but but no, like when they put the tube down the throat and pulled the teeth out, like she looked raggedy. She looked not infected.
But that also looked like a woman with teeth.
It did, but maybe they grew back.
I don't know. Look,
no, because I think the other one was brunette.
She was Sweeney Todd's wife. That's what it was.
You all speculated.
Speculating who that woman out of all the mycotics was, when there's no signal whatsoever that it was anything other than just one of them.
Why can't
is
it
a waste
be
of time?
They wrote her for a reason, and the lines she delivers talks about pain and being in the dark hole where they want you forgotten.
Pain and the dark hole where you want to be forgotten is just brimming with jokes. But Peter revealed once again that he's a weasel and that he is a coward. Okay.
And even Neil said last episode, like, do you think Peter would have left Alan there? He's like, oh yeah, like he didn't even like pause.
100%. But that's the thing. Not only did he give up all of his information, he didn't even think to be like, pull me up out of this hole and then I will give you information.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing, is like, if he wants to threaten to leave you there for a year, then just don't panic and just be like, cool dude, I'll be dead long before you get any of my important information.
Well, he doesn't want to dig a deeper hole for himself.
I want a dollar for every time we say hole in this episode.
I really don't.
Because I can buy lunch.
No, because that's... all he could have done is like give like the half the information. You give like the tease of the information enough that he wants more.
Give him a morsel, a little aperitif.
Yeah, like, hey, she's got an immortal baby, but you don't know where till I tell you. So how about getting me out of this... drop down.
Yeah, it's still pregnant.
I'm sorry. You tell someone that someone has an immortal baby, but you don't know where it is. I would look down a bit in that hall and be like, it's in her stomach, isn't it? And you'd be like...
No, and then you look up and like, technically, you don't know anatomy because it's in her womb.
No, where'd you get that suit?
Well played.
Boom. St. Germain toilet store?
It could be an actual baby at this point. It could be like a born child. So it could. What if that was what happened? She gave birth to the child, and then it was just a baby, like this big of a baby forever.
Yeah,
that's what I was saying.
It became crazy smart.
It's like zombie babies.
Yeah,
you never see them because they never like. Care for them.
They had one on Z Nation.
They had a zombie baby.
All right.
Anyway, moving on.
I want to talk.
I just wanted to say that's the exact point I was making before about what would be the point of him having a silver with one of his daughters because it's just a freaking baby.
We have 9 minutes.
Okay.
We have 15.
Oh, we do?
Ha!
Oh, stellar. That's not what the clock says.
I know.
I want to talk about Amy, okay? We learned a whole lot about her. I personally, even though I hate her methods, I completely understand what she's doing. And I wish that she would just come clean with our CDC folks. Why isn't she? Why is she still resorting to manipulating Landry, which ultimately backfired?
I don't think she trusts them.
Hmm. Well, yeah, but also, again, like what I was saying before, I give her lots of credit for being this amazing, very intelligent person who didn't, like you said, drink the Kool-Aid. But this is probably how she's had to survive her entire life here, is by manipulating, lying, keeping secrets with herself, and only trusting very few people. Why change that now to jeopardize what she's been planning for years?
You know what? I think she was about to trust them. She went after Dr. Dick Texas from the beginning. I think she was going to use him to get off the island.
Right.
Yeah.
But like when he rejected her... That's Dr. Detexas for you. Like, he could have, like, had the ins of the whole organization.
That's what I'm saying.
Wait till Sergio gets there.
sense.
True. But the same way that last season, no girl. Alan was...
That's what I was about to say. That's why he's not
sick. Oh, you want to start that conversation?
Samey.
He did say how much he enjoyed watching her work.
Up until, yeah, this is the season.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been watching every episode.
Okay.
Until episode 6.
Okay, that's see, that's
trying to catch me
clarity
in a
of language.
He gets a Balacero job.
No. For him, it's not a job, okay? It's a hobby.
It's a hand hobby.
Hand passion actually works too well to be.
You gotta wear gloves for safety.
So,
moving forward.
Right, moving forward. Now after all the jokes, I've lost my train of thought.
We're talking about Amy and all of her plans on the island.
So she just got a whole bunch of people sick. She got Landry to do it simply because she wanted Michael to have more to deal with, so that maybe, just maybe, she could slip away unnoticed, or his power could erode, or something. She's just trying to destabilize.
And also, she's a human who has been manipulating people all of her life.
Yeah.
When you are a human and you manipulate people, you manipulate them for a reason, to get stuff.
Yeah.
And ultimately, humans want. A lot of these type of people want the power.
Mm-hmm.
So you never know what she's...
Power and freedom.
You know what I mean? Like, she's got so many different designs in that hamster wheel of hers that you just gotta keep watching.
I see her... She already threw Anne under the bus.
Yep.
She threw Anne under the bus with a honey jar.
You think that she did that?
She did that, yeah.
She had to have. Did you see that scene where she's like, no, she couldn't have done it, but then she just had... She looked at Landry, and then there's just this...
See, I thought that
she
he
smized.
Did.
No, he did, but I think he...
Landry,
she got,
you mean?
Landry
yeah,
did, Landry,
I thought he did it. I thought he was against her in that moment.
Landry did it for her.
For her.
And she's making a manipulation play at both of them. She basically just turned Anne to go against Brother Michael, as well as earned the right as the favorite daughter at the same time. So she's gained two allies from a power move. So right now she's working both angles, and she's going to try to figure out how to... basically become the leader of everything here, it looks like.
I don't
maybe
think she
not
wants
that.
To,
I don't know. There's a few ways it could
go. Short-term goal is
leader.
Not to get done by her dad. That is the only goal right now.
Well, here's my question, though. Her ultimate goal, is it, does she want to kill Michael or just get off the island?
I think it's just get out of Dodge and have a normal life.
And if it requires killing Michael, then she probably would, but yeah. I think it's more complicated than that.
She doesn't want to kill him. She's not actively attempting to kill Michael.
She just is avoiding the plantaning.
Yes. She does not want to be planted.
I think she just watched Castaway. She could have left by now.
Yeah.
Wow.
So we also have...
What was the hand motion for the planting, Matt?
Oh, that?
Yeah.
Planting. This motion?
This is the planting?
Never a dumb
Everyone
never
together.
I'm eating candy.
This
now
is
I'm set.
Easily the most...
No.
This is the most frustrating show in the world to leave.
Probably because it's so amazing.
So let me just really quickly, Kyle and Alan and Sarah. Alan and Kyle do not like each other. Sarah does not like Kyle right now because he's not being super trustworthy, but they are forced to work together. On and on as far as we go. Okay, it's time for predictions.
There's one actually thing that we forgot to mention.
Which is what?
Alan being Hank.
Strobes, yeah. I mean, we strobe the floor, man.
Oh, yeah. Time machine.
Dr. Alan got...
He got time machine.
Handry time machined Alan and forced him to start 50 Shades-ing Sarah by choking her. And then the other thing we didn't mention is that Amy has been hiding Olivia since she stabbed Sarah and basically manipulates Amy into creating an uprising to pull all the infected
See,
people
I
out.
See, I thought she set her free. Olivia. I thought that she was a captive.
She set her free. Like, she meant to act like she was locked up for stabbing
Sarah. Yeah, she was locked up. She wasn't hiding her.
She was punished.
She was locked up, but she conveniently left the door open saying, I wish somebody would do something about the CDC, and then left it. Now there's like a thing, and then things are going down, and boom, predictions go.
There we go.
All okay, right. I'm predicting, I think we're going to come back. Sarah's going to die, but she's not going to die, because we learned from what's his name? The
Viking.
The Viking guy, yeah. They don't just... live forever. It's not like you can't kill them. They will die and then basically come back. Like, he starved to death hundreds of times being in that basement.
As long as your body is still functional, it will start functioning again.
Yeah.
If there's no head, you're screwed.
Exactly.
Yeah. No heart, you're screwed.
So small prediction, I don't think Alan knows that, so I think he kills her, like, leaves, and then she has to, like, sort of sneak around the base to, like, get back.
Unless somebody comes in and, like, I mean, because we don't know. We imagine that he probably knocked out or, like, did something to Kyle, but for all we know, in the next episode, he's going to run in, like, no, I'll save you, and just, you know, he's totally got a thing.
It's a great impression.
Help?
Yeah, I know, right? I was practicing on it.
Judah, I'm going to save you.
That's...
Citrakian, that
I'm Batman.
That sounded more like him. Okay. I think an unexpected person's going to come upon Peter in the cage and get Peter out.
That'd be fun.
And I think the unexpected person's gonna be Sergio.
See?
Really?
That's a bold prediction.
That is very bold.
See, the one thing for me is we get that one shot of the CGI rat, and it made it seem like that rat was definitely gonna bite him, and he was gonna get poisoned in a big way. I don't know.
Not poison. It was just eating. I'm laughing at what Mark was saying because we were having a talk about it. He's like, if someone threw a rat on you, would you be like, ah? Or just like, damn it.
It was
like,
just the horror scream of the rats. I guess they're on instant eat mode.
He said
like,
they
rats,
had
they switched them on to eat mode because like Pac-Man just goes and
he said he had starved.
Don't you just like stomp all the rats and then be fine?
Would the rat kind of land on you, sniff around, maybe take a look, mm-hmm. you know? But no, these guys are like eat.
They're rat darts.
Yeah.
They're rat darts.
Liz.
Oh God. I think if we're gonna, if a character is gonna die, like I'm honestly thinking at one point, like Landry is definitely gonna like go. Like,
oh, totally.
Yeah, like definitely. But I'm seeing
no way he survives.
If not next episode, I'm thinking it's coming soon though. Like I think she's going to use him, or he's going to do the ultimate sacrifice because he loves her so much.
Oh no, she's gonna have to kill him because he's not gonna want to go along with it anymore.
She's going to set him up. With Michael,
so
yeah,
to keep Anne as an ally.
Okay, so I thought you meant sexually.
God,
we don't know what happens to the sons.
I do. What?
So there have been sons.
I'm not even saying.
By pure chance,
could
like,
Miguin and Sergio be brother Michael's sons?
Absolutely not.
not a prayer.
But I would love to see, I think, because now we have Julia coming back. Like, in theory, she now knows about Saint Germain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Present day Julia.
Right.
Present day Julia.
Yeah, she does.
Could that somehow, because we still have to figure out what Caleb's doing there, if it doesn't turn out to be Sarah's baby.
Can I throw out something completely batshit, stupid, insane?
Yes.
Do it.
No, he's not. Okay, so Alan and Peter talk all the time about their dad. They have a terrible dad, he's so bad. What if he wasn't their dad at all? He wasn't their dad at all, and they are two of Brother Michael's kids.
No.
Come on.
Wow.
I mean, it's...
Come on. I know it's stupid.
That's like season 7 stuff.
I know it's a stupid idea.
Boy,
but
remember,
look at his hair.
Peter, when
look
Dad
at his
would always
features.
Try to plant us, and I would give you the symbol.
Why are you doing Syfy-ian? All I'm saying is, you look at Steven Weber, you look at Billy Campbell, you look at Neil Napier. They look of a kind, and not just because they're white guys.
You're right. I could see them being related.
I could see them all being related.
I think it's, no, you know what? It's because since Neil grew out his hair, and Brother Michael has the longer hair, too, and the light eyes.
Neil
like,
loves
I mean,
that hair, by the way.
I know he does.
He loves his hair.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure he does.
Yeah.
Or black right, hair. Can I throw out an even crazier theory? Please. Or maybe not as crazy. That's pretty nuts. But what if we get, like, as we're trying to figure out Caleb's origins, what if Sergio...
Oh,
is his father. If he comes to the island, maybe hooks up with Amy.
Absolutely.
And then we get Caleb.
What color are Amy's eyes? Does Amy remember?
What
color are Amy's eyes?
Not like
brown.
Silver.
Okay, no, because I was going to say, if they're blue and his eyes are green, then there's no way that Caleb can be their son because he has brown eyes. Boom.
So I have one last question for you, Mark. Do they call brothels on the island plantations?
Because of the planting?
Aww. It's really an unfortunate joke, and you're going to regret
it. I haven't been on the island, so.
Yeah. It was an unfortunate accident.
Yeah. Zach, where can the people find you?
You guys can follow me on Twitter at ThatZachWilson, ThatZachWilson. A bunch of shows here at AfterBuzz. Later tonight, on Better Call Saul with these two guys. Reyes Seahorn will be joining us. Kim from Better Call Saul. Tune in.
The blonde lawyer, if you watch. Hey, guys, I'm Stephen Lemieux. Find me on Twitter at Stephen Lemieux, STPHENLEMIEUX, as well as doing the Better Call Saul AfterBuzz TV show here and the last episode of Sleepy Hollow tomorrow. Check that out.
Okay. I like the voice that you just heard. Yeah. Hey, guys, it's Mark Ghanime here. You can follow me at Twitter at Mark Ghanime, MarkGhanime. Whoa, that was awesome.
Fuck you, man. That was so much on my thing.
You see, the announcer voices are fun.
I am tuning in AfterBuzz TV. Liz Rishmawy on the KGLH 105.7. Check her out on The Rock. Find her at Lizzie Maui.
Hey. It's a really good candy.
We have to,
you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Lizzie Maui. That's at LIZZYMAWY. That's it.
And folks, you can find me on Twitter at Matt Lieberman, MattLieberman. You can also find me here on AfterBuzz doing Banshee and Better Call Saul, my YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/MattLieberman, SourceFed and SourceFed Nerd. Thank you all for joining us. We'll be back next week. Good night.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
See you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.